Stowe University Physics, she goes to look there, but as other things, she sent me a cosmology,
Great. So, you know, being from Vancouver, where it's usually slightly warmer than here, and walking here today in the snow, I briefly consider changing my thought pedal to details of Hawaii. I think I thought I'd spruce up your afternoon, but instead I will talk about an even hotter place, the center of the universe. And as Richard mentioned, I'm interested in all sorts of questions about the universe, and in particular about all the physics we don't understand about the universe nowadays, because we understand so much about the CMB, for instance. So I would like to understand what physics dark matter has. I would like to understand, you know, exactly what is dark energy. Questions like why are we made of atoms instead of anti-atoms, and how did the universe begin? These are the things that really get me excited. And there's four questions here. And as you can imagine, there are many possible answers to all of these questions. So first of all, I want to complain to Jen and Richard, because originally I was hoping to get 5 hours of time to talk to you guys. And originally my talk title was 10 minutes. But they forced me to cut it down. So I'm not going to give you the full version, the full 5 hour version here, but I will advertise a couple things, because I'm going to be around all day tomorrow, so I'd be happy to chat with you about everything. So some stuff that I will not be talking about today. So I will not be talking about the Canadian Hydrogen Intensity Mapping Experiment, which is a radio telescope designed to detect dark energy, and I won't be talking about the forecasting and foreground work that Richard Shaw, my grad student Michael Sidwell, and Wade Penn and I are doing. I won't tell you how you can use strong lensing to learn about the physics of dark matter, in detail, which is work that I'm doing with my grad student Francis Servicine, Lexi Moustakis, and a team of about 50 people around the world who are trying to use strong lensing, probably from space, to probe dark matter probabilities. I won't tell you about that. And I won't tell you about the theory of atomic dark matter that Francis and I have worked out the cosmological perturbations, and I won't tell you about dark matter acoustic oscillations. And I won't tell you about another model of dark matter. It's kind of cute that I've been thinking about fermion nugget dark matter, where dark matter is very light particles that have strong self-interactions and become self-bound into degenerate objects, kind of like neutron stars, and end up being a viable dark matter. And today only, I won't tell you about the evolution of perturbations before and during repeating in models with dark matter annihilation, which is what Adrian and I have been thinking about. It's follow-up to the paper that just came out recently. And I also want to tell you about the quantification of perturbations in an inflating elastic solid. Okay. I'm also not going to tell you about cosmological perturbation theory, including weak interactions, which is my address to LHAM, LH4, UDC, and I've been working at the details of, and I won't tell you about baryonic photon perturbations, including the effects of Rayleigh scattering. And to top it off, I don't know if you've been counting, in the final two, I won't tell you about cosmological perturbations and structure formation and theories of lukewarm dark matter. And I also won't tell you, because I don't know what it is yet, but the new idea that Fantails of the Yearly Universe that I will not be talking about. And if you call right now, we can give you free shipping and throw in an extra free Tails of the Yearly Universe. I will be talking about my two most sort of most recent papers. So I'll be discussing a theory for the origin of matter in the universe. And that'll take about half the time of the talk, and then I'll go on and talk about a completely different topic, which is potential observational consequences for collisions between bubble universes before inflation. Okay. So, rolling right along, the origin of matter. What do I mean by matter? Well, I mean both baryonic matter, atoms and normal stuff, and I also mean dark matter. So this is a unified setup where you can create all matter at the same time. We call it hylogenesis, or if there's any Greek people in the audience, hylogenesis. But Canadians pronounce it hylogenesis. And I'll tell you about an interesting new signature that, if this theory is the right theory of how matter is created, this gives us a new way to detect dark matter in the universe. So we really have to go back 80 years or so to start this discussion. And the fact that we have particles and antiparticles as an idea at all goes back to Dirac and the Dirac equation, trying to understand atomic structure. And if you go into the details of the Dirac equation, as you all know, you end up having four states in order to satisfy the constraint conditions, instead of two states that you'd expect for a spin 2 particle. And those extra two states are the positron. And ever since then we've had to worry about antiparticles. And in particular, why is it that everything seems to be made of what we call hydrogen and not made of anti-hydrogen? And there is this excess of baryons or anti-baryons in the universe, without which not a lot of interesting physics would be happening in the universe today. And this is now verified within our Hubble volume in gory detail, both by constraints from Big Bang nucleosynthesis, which tell us a certain density of baryons over anti-baryons, and then also, remarkably, with the same number from measurements of the CMB, that really nails down that as far as we can see, everything is made of matter and not antimatter. And this is sort of, this has been around as a problem for quite some time, and I think it's something that particle physicists and cosmologists just like to sweep under the rug and ignore it for now, and hopefully we'll find another way to a good way to address it in the future. But I think it's something that's really interesting and needs to be up there with dark matter and dark energy as one of the big mysteries of the universe. So how do you end up with a baryon asymmetry? Sakharov wrote down his conditions in this paper here. I've been told that this is some kind of poetry. I forgot what the line was in, unfortunately. But yeah, beware when you grab PDF files off the internet. So he had a paper which was kind kind of bizarre, actually. It was talking about how you can go through a big crunch and end up, you know, if you have a positive baryon number on one side, go through the crunch and end up with a negative baryon number on the other side. So it was really not the context that we think about baryogenesis today, but he wrote down these conditions, and those are the things that have stuck around and you see fall over. So to create a baryon asymmetry, you need some reaction that violates this baryon charge. You need both C and CP violation, and you need some kind of departure from thermal equilibrium, because if you don't have a departure, then any sort of stuff that is creating a baryon number will be in detailed balance with stuff that's destroying baryon number, and you won't get a net baryon number of flavors. So can we do this with the standard model? And the answer is no. And although baryon can be violated by rare processes, the amount, the rate of this happening, and the amount of CP violation that we know about the standard model cannot create this number that is now well measured for the baryon, the photon machine. But people have come up with viable theories, and I would say one of them is called leptogenesis, and I would say that if you took a survey of particle physicists, it might be the favorite. And the idea is you can have regular neutrinos are left-handed, but you can have heavy right-handed neutrinos in the early universe that decay out of equilibrium and generate a lepton number, which then gets converted to baryon number through processes that conserve the difference of baryon number and lepton number. And because you can put extra CPA symmetry into this system, you can end up with enough CP violation so this actually works, and you get, you can fit the data and get 6 times 10 to the minus 6 of the baryon to photon ratio. And so the point I want you to take away here is that baryogenesis requires some sort of new physics beyond what we know about in order to fit the data. And the popular theory now, if you like leptogenesis, is that this new physics could be at a rather high scale, 10 to the 14 GeV, could be a typical mass scale in this theory. And that's unfortunate because, save for maybe connecting this up with inflation, there's not a lot of probes of energies that high. Now, let's look at the other matter we know about in the universe, namely dark matter. We know some things about dark matter. We know its abundance from the CMB. We have constraints on self-scattering cross-section. We know that that can't be too big from things like the bullet cluster. And we know that it must have been born with not too much momentum initially, because otherwise it would have free stream and you would not see the matter power spectrum observed by Sloan. You would see some cutoff showing that the universe is filled with hot dark matter. And that's not the case. We also know that it interacts by gravity, and it is responsible for holding together galaxies and clusters of galaxies. So those are the things that we know. So we know nowadays quite a bit more than we did 20 years ago, say. But still, dark matter physics is very much a game of unknowns. What I described are astrophysical properties that we need. The reason the ESHRA for dark matter is to satisfy those astrophysical properties. It's not the physics of dark matter, which is a more fundamental field theory of some sort that describes how dark matter interacts with itself and other stuff in the universe. So there's tons of dark matter unknowns, and this is not a comprehensive list. We don't know how many components of dark matter there are. Maybe it actually has weird gravity. Maybe it doesn't interact in the normal way. It doesn't have self-interaction. I'm really sorry that Dick is not here, because this is my new word, dastrophysics, for funky gastrophysics in the dark sector. We don't know all of this stuff, and we don't even know, we've got an exhaustive list of questions here. So, we need to think really carefully and make sure that we've got at least all the questions, and we know all the places to look for dark matter. And we've thought about every rock and nook and cranny to look in to find any trace of what dark matter would be. Because it's just a big unknown. Now, you've probably heard a story about dark matter, and I'm going to tell you very briefly, and this is known as the wind miracle. So, if we have, in the early universe, weakly interacting massive particles that are stable, or at least stable on cosmological timescales, then just from the freeze-out of the annihilation rate of these particles from a thermal abundance in the early universe, if we say that these particles have a mass scale associated with their interactions of about 100 GeV, so the electroweak scale, and we give them couplings to each other or standard model things of above electroweak coupling, then to within a couple of orders of magnitude, you get the right dark matter abundance. And this was noticed some time ago, and it's because the weak scale is one of the scales we know about in nature, this is very interesting because we can think about extending physics at the weak scale, which is the same scales that are being probed in more detail now at the LHC, and we can have a good candidate for what dark matter could be. And it satisfies all of these different criteria about dark matter astrophysics that I mentioned a few minutes ago. Now, one thing to notice about this scenario is that you have an equal number of dark matter particles and antiparticles. So dark matter is quite different compared to baryons. Baryons, you only have dark matter, you have equal amounts of dark matter and antimatter. And that means, for instance, that the dark matter is able to annihilate today galaxies. Okay. So, WIMPs are a pretty compelling idea, but still, really, it's just an idea that someone has dreamt up. So I'm going to tell you about another idea that I've dreamt up now. First let me point something out to you. And that's problem number 5. The great thing is that we know the ratio of the dark matter density to the baryon density in the universe. The bad thing is that it's 5. Okay, so why is that bad? Well, who ordered 5? Why is it this number? Why does it have to be in order unity? Why isn't it a million or 1/623? And this is a little bit funny. Maybe it's just a coincidence, but it's a little bit funny. The energy densities or number densities of dark matter, if you imagine dark matter, say a WIMP, are very similar, but then I've just said that baryogenesis, is perhaps a theory that depends on physics at very, very high scales. And with this very, very high scale physics, it's been tuned just right so that you get this density of baryons. And dark matter is completely unrelated physics at the electroweak scale, if you believe in WIMPs. And yet, somehow these completely unrelated phenomena have ended up with similar densities, despite the fact that baryons are completely asymmetric. You only have particles, no antiparticles, and in wind models, you have no net dark matter number, there's an equal number of particles and antiparticles. So this begs the question that I've been mentioned a couple of times now, why are these so similar if they have different origins in the early universe? And in particular, maybe this is pointing, telling us that there's actually something here, and this got me and Homer Simpson thinking that maybe this is a clue to what's going on. Can we come up with a theory that instead takes this factor of five as a pointer to what the physics of baryogenesis and dark matter are? And that brings us to hylogenesis. So hylogenesis is a word that's I just made up, that I borrow from philosophy, which means primordial matter, and genesis in Greek, and all the best physics words are Greek, so it seems like a good idea. And this is work that I've done in collaboration with Kuman Davidezel, David Morrissey, and Sean Tulin at Triumph, and more recently Nikita Blinov is a graduate student at UBC. Working out an extension of this theory to supersymmetric particles. So the amazing thing is, you go out and you think about this stuff, and you write an obscure paper and you post it in the archive, and then some random person in Finland decides to put it on Wikipedia. It's just weird. I like the theory, but I like the fact that this word is now ambiguous. Okay. How does this work? Well, we propose to link, the problem here that I was pointing out is that the number densities of baryons and dark matter were so similar. And so we're going to go ahead and we're going to make a mechanism where they end up being basically equal to order of nature. And we're going to do that by having a new heavy field that couples to quarks. It couples to a combination of quarks that looks like a neutron, because it's really hard to couple things to quarks in other ways without screwing up everything up completely. And we also are going to couple it to new hidden states in some hidden sector, and these hidden states will end up being dark matter. And we're going to explain what's going on with the densities by saying that actually the number densities are equal, and that you have a balance between the positive baryon charge that's stored in quarks that we're made of, and there's a negative baryon charge that's in these hidden states sitting in the hidden sector. Okay, so this gives you a relationship between these densities of dark matter and baryons that now depends on the masses of the hidden states that make up the dark matter. So in this theory, the dark matter is actually made up of two states. There's a Y state, which is a fermion, and there's a Y state, which is a scalar. We just did that because this is the simplest thing we can write down to couple to X, which is a heavy fermion. So X has a mass scale of about a TeV or higher, and Y and Phi have a mass scale of about a GeV in order to satisfy this ratio of Phi. And I'm first going to discuss this simple minimal model that fulfills all of the requirements we need to make this theory work. And then at the end of this part of the talk, I'll talk about some new work on a supersymmetric extension, which is more satisfying from a theoretical point of view.
So if this dark matter sector carries varying number,
it carries varying.
You would expect it to be weakly interacting, I think.
With,
in general.
With normal matter. And
so
that's,
then why doesn't it annihilate? Can you explain that?
I'm going to explain it. That's my new channel for effective matter. Okay, so this gives, you'll notice that this gives you baryogenesis without net baryon number violation. And that's just because instead of violating baryon number, you're just transferring it into a very weakly coupled hidden sector. So if you only care about quarks, it's effectively like a baryon number violation. But in detail, you don't have to think about it that way. You just sequestering these two baths that don't talk to each other very efficiently. Next thing is that dark matter is anti-baryonic. This means, as Chris said, that you can annihilate baryons. And in fact, dark matter can very rarely, you know, pass through stuff on the Earth and turn protons and neutrons into mesons. So that looks like proton decay. And because of that, we can, you know, this is a constraint on the theory, and it and also means that you can potentially detect dark matter in proton decay experiments. And last but not least, I'll explain why we expect to have a signal in direct detection experiments as well. I'll come back to that in a few minutes to explain why we do expect, even though this stuff is very weakly interacting, it may actually have some kind of elastic scattering as well. So this, in pictures, this is how it works. We start off in the early universe, CP symmetric, so we have an equal number of baryons, antibaryons, dark matter, and anti-dark matter. And through this hylogenesis mechanism, we displace some of the charge. We create an excess of baryon charge and an excess of anti-baryon charge and, or anti-dark matter charge dark matter sector. And then once the symmetric pieces, the bulk of these two charges annihilate away. So in the standard model case, this will be, you know, once the QCD phase transition occurs and you all the quarks get down left at the baryons, the temperature of the universe is less than the mass of a proton, and all of the baryons go away. You just end up with this balance between the charges of baryons and dark matter. I just want to point out that the idea that you can sequester baryon number in some non-interacting sector is not new. And in fact, Doyleson and Woodrow thought about it in 1990, and there may have well been examples before that, but I'm not aware of any. The other thing you need to have in this scenario is that you can't have the entire universe in equilibrium for the same reason as you always have in baryogenesis models. Otherwise, the inverse reactions will just wipe everything out. And you know, if this is in equilibrium, these asymmetries would go away and wouldn't be able to persist. Okay, so.
And you're in that sketch there, the dark matter and the anti-dark matter are coupled much, much more strongly to each other than they are between psychics, right? Does that necessarily have to be true if you do it?
Yeah, it does. Yeah. You need to, because other if they're not coupled to each other strongly enough, they can't annihilate away.
Sure, but and then couldn't you annihilate it at all If you can say they coupled, say dark matter coupled strongly, well, I guess they can't couple too strongly, so you can see it today, but could you generate that asymmetry as it's cooling down and not have to have the anti-dark matter coupled so strongly to the dark matter?
Like, yeah, so I don't, I mean, when you say generate these asymmetry as it's cooling down, I don't understand.
So first you generate an asymmetry when there's still lots of dark matter in it, and anti-dark matter, right? And then you then you separate these two sectors and you let them annihilate away. Couldn't you just in the early universe have the baryons and the dark matter, the anti-dark matter sort of coupled, and as the universe cools down, couldn't you generate the asymmetry then without having this intermediate state where you have where you have much more dark matter and anti-dark matter?
Okay. So somehow you don't have anything, but through some process you just transfer, you create a little bit of dark matter.
Right, as the baryons are decaying.
I think in principle that could work. I just don't know a way to set that up. As long as it's not an equilibrium. Okay, so the players here are some new TeV scale particles, Dirac fermions, our dark matter states Y and Phi. A new gauge boson that these dark matter states are charged under. We need that because we need some sort of strong interaction between these dark matter states in order to have them annihilate away. And this E1 prime is a simple way to do that. We assign a baryon number 1 to these heavy fermions, which then communicates this baryon number to this combination of Y and Phi. They don't have to, as long as the total baryon charge adds up to -1, you're fine. For instance, you can take Y to be 1/2, and that would be a pretty good solution. And in fact, you need to have the baryon number be 1/2 if you want this supersymmetric version of the theory to work. I mentioned before we coupled the neutron portal. So how does this work in detail? Okay, so we produce an equal number of these heavy states, these X and X bar particles, non-thermally in the universe at the time of reheating, or it could be at a later stage where if there's some other scalar field, say a modulus, dominates the universe at late times, starts oscillating, and dumps its energy partially into these X and X1 bar fields. This gives you your departure from equilibrium, because now you have this coherently oscillating field that's decaying, and that's good enough to give you an out of equilibrium decay situation. Once you produce these equal numbers of these X and X bar particles, then the X particles either decay into quarks and anti-dark matter, and the X bars either decay into anti-quarks or dark matter. And because of CP violation, the rate that X decays into quarks, or X bar decays into anti-quarks, is perturbed a little bit in a way that's equal and opposite. So this is a little higher, this one's a little lower. And in detail, the amount that is perturbed in the dark matter case is equal and opposite. Okay, so that's the pattern of decay rates that the CP violation gives you. And it has to have this pattern because if this is a Lorentz invariant theory and you have the CPT theorem. And so since you have CPT, the total decay rate of X and X bar must be the same. You just changed what channels they're decaying into. You get the CP violation by having quantum mechanical interference between two processes. So an X can either decay, say, into three quarks, or it can have a loop process go into this other excited state, X2, and then decay into three quarks. And because these have the same final states, you have to add them up at the amplitude level. That gives you the opportunity to have a complex phase, and that's what gives you the CP violation in this model. So it's possible to get enough CP violation to generate the dark matter abundance we need. Okay, so so after you've gone from X and X bar, you now have quarks and this anti-dark matter, and quarks. And there's no violation of the total baryon number because you've just shifted things around in a slightly asymmetric way.
So how easy is it, maybe you embed this in, but how easy is it to embed this in a ground unified array, say, without...
Well, I'll talk about this a little bit at the end. I mean, it's not going to be a grand unified theory in the sense that I'm not trying to unify strong electromagnetism and B forces together. But you can embed it in a supersymmetric theory, which has certain nice features in terms of if you want to have a light scalar. Susie here is a good way to go. Okay, so once you've set this up, this stage, you've got everything's fine in terms of the total balance of baryon number, but you still have particles and antiparticles both in the visible and hidden sector, and you need to annihilate them away. In the quarks, as I mentioned, you can annihilate quarks into gluons and photons and all of the standard model bosons and fermions. To eliminate these dark matter states, if they have this U1 prime interaction, they can annihilate into this Z prime. Quite generically, when you talk about having an extra photon-like state, a massive photon-like state, you can have a mixing term, kinetic mixing between this state and a real photon. And so what that means is you create these Z primes, and then eventually they decay into electron-positron pairs or whatever states that are accessible to both, depending on the mass. So once you've done that, you've arrived at the final situation, which we have now. You've got baryons and dark matter, both in the universe, asymmetrically, but with a balance between their charges. We want these hidden anti-baryons to be dark matter particles, and that puts constraints on their masses. Right? If they were really massive, they would just decay to an antiproton or something really fast. There's nothing preventing that. And you can show that both these states can be stable if you have this condition. So basically, the mass splitting between the states must be less than the mass of a proton. And then you get this sort of mutual non-decay pact between the three states, the proton and the two dark matter states. Any of the other two states have a mass that's greater than any one of the states. Okay, and so this will give you the right density, provided that these states have a mass between both 2 and 3 g. If you want to satisfy the dark matter density in the CMB. So how can you detect these? You can detect these from elastic scattering of dark matter from nucleons. That's direct detection. And because it has, in a model where this thing couples to this Z prime, the Z prime has an interaction with quarks, and so you can calculate how big the the cross-section for elastic scattering through this Z prime boson off the quarks. Right now, the issue is in this low mass range, the way dark matter detection experiments work is by looking for energy that's deposited in the experiment, but they don't have a lot of sensitivity to these low mass dark matter particles because you have a mismatch between the mass of the particles you're scattering off in these low mass states. And so the energy thresholds sort of tail off below 10 GeV or so. So right now there's not a constraint, but it would be really interesting to have lower energy thresholds in dark matter direct detection experiments. There is no indirect detection signal because there are no, there's only, depending how you think about it, only dark matter particles or only dark matter antiparticles, and you don't have this annihilation signal in the signature, so Fermi won't see anything if this is the right theory of dark matter. But you have another direct signal, and that's the destruction of nucleons by dark matter scattering. The dark matter carries a negative baryon number, and although you can't decay, you can scatter off of baryons and have this baryon number annihilate. So you can have a process like this where a proton gets bumped by a dark matter particle and turns into a kaon and an anti-dark matter particle. And since we don't see the dark matter at all we see is a proton turning into a kaon and missing energy, and that's the same signature that we see in a proton decay experiment, like they did at super K. So we call this process induced nucleon decay, and since we think we know what the density of dark matter is at the radius of the solar system in our galaxy, we can calculate the expected flux of dark matter on the Earth, just as you do for normal dark matter detection experiments. And from this, you can infer an effective light time on particles on Earth to this induced nucleon decay process. So the best bound on this rate from Super K 2005 is about 10 to the 33. And if you just do an estimate, putting in one for all the coupling constants and what have you, we find that this induced nucleon decay rate is 10 to the 32. So that's pretty interesting. It's just sort of accidental with the dark matter density. Where we are in the galaxy happens to be right on this edge, where it's, you know, it's possible because if you had a slightly more sensitive experiment, you'd be able to detect this sort of induced nucleon decay process. The difference between this process and regular nucleon decay is that the proton is at rest and decays. In this case, depending on whether you're scattering from the heavier state to the lighter state or the lighter state to the heavier state, you're going to either give or take away some kinetic energy. And if you give it kinetic energy, then the kaon you produce can be moving relativistically for some period and emit a Cherenkov cone in the super K factor. And it turns out that the current limits are derived assuming there's no Cherenkov cone. And all events with this extra Cherenkov cone would have already been vetoed. But fortunately, the data is still available. In the opposite case, the super K limits do apply. And we can exclude some regions of the dark matter mass for the downscattering, because this downscattering is expected to occur based on current super K data. So this was kind of an interesting surprise that we can actually, yeah.
So why is there the gap?
Why is there the gap?
And why?
Right. So if the masses are, well, first of all, there's a constraint on the sum of the masses, right? So MY can either be the heavier one or the lighter one. So that's why it's symmetric about the center here, that adds up to 2.5. If you're in the if you're in the center, then if you're completely degenerate, then you're at some point let me think about that and get back to you. I managed to confuse myself, so I'll come back to that one. Okay, so and there's two possible processes. There's one that depends on neutrons going to neutral mesons, and one that depends on protons going to charged K mesons. If you have this interaction, then anytime you have quarks interacting with each other, you can produce this extra X state potentially, which then decays to other stuff, and you can have potentially missing energy, and you can also produce what are known as monojets at colliders. And current bounds are on this mass scale of the interaction, are between 200 and 500 GeV. Actually, the current limits from the LHC do apply, and this limit of this mass scale must be greater than TeV. The TeV scale is the current limit. Okay, so we need this Z prime. So an interesting. We did this D prime that goes on for the dark matter to annihilate, because the Z prime must mix with the standard model in order to facilitate this annihilation. We would predict that you can go and look for photons very rarely becoming this Z prime goes on, and if you have a really high intensity particle experiment that's not high energy, it has a lot of beam, then you have the potential to discover these extra gauge bosons that are mixing with standard model stuff. Last but not least, if you have this dark matter that's antibaryonic, it can capture in stars, and if you capture too much of it in stars, it can, in the worst case, it can eat up the whole star. Okay, it's not that strongly interacting. But it can deposit energy into the star, and in particular, neutron stars have a very high density baryons. This kind of dark matter can capture and form a core in the center of these neutron stars and heat up the neutron stars. It turns out that this process takes a dark matter particle and turns it into an antiparticle. And so you may have, know about monopole catalyzed nucleon decay, which a monopole comes in and causes nucleon decay and produces another monopole, which is available then to destroy more nucleons in the neutron star. And it puts strict limits on the monopole flux in the neutron stars. The same thing doesn't happen here, because of this transformation into the anti-state. So once you've created the anti-state, this thing just sits around and it actually annihilates with a dark matter particle that happens to be at the core. This releases energy, and basically you get the same limits on the energy injection from this model as you do from conventional versus red models.
Can we go back to the early universe again? Because this is basically why I was asking about the weak interaction and why can't this type of process happen in the universe and effectively facilitate the, you know, the self-annihilation of the dark sector?
Right.
And the transfer of baryon number from the two sectors.
So I kind of skipped over this part, but one of the in the reheating history, this all ostensibly depends on the reheating temperature. Okay. So provided the reheating temperature is less than when the inverse reactions that will wash out the asymmetry, then you're fine. Okay. But this is actually an example of.
But this is very low temperature here compared. The center of the sun is very low temperature compared with the reheating temperature, right? So.
The difference here is that you have elastic scattering and you can capture. And once you capture, the interaction is strong enough, you're going to have, you have a lots of chances to annihilate.
And that's actually more effective if you integrate over the age of the sun than integrating over the history of the universe when the universe is very dense and hot.
The universe was never hot enough for the inverse reaction to become efficient.
Well, but the difference I understand, but you know, even if the reheating temperature is low, the universe, when it reheated, was still had a much higher energy density than the sun, right? It's
not just the energy density. It's also the number density.
Sure.
This process doesn't depend on high energies.
Well, that's what I meant.
Right?
I meant number density. I meant number density.
So it's just that you get captured, and then you get to integrate basically the optical depth forever from that point onward, and the expected lifetime is less than the age of a star.
Okay. Well, there's two big and small factors here, and I can't do the numbers in my head. So okay, sorry.
Okay. All right, so let me just mention this quickly. So we're currently polishing off a supersymmetric version of this theory. And the reason we want to do this is because for the same reason that people are upset about having a Higgs at 100 GeV, you may get upset about having a particle that's a fundamental scalar that's 1 GeV. And if you introduce supersymmetry, it can protect the masses of these states in the same way that you can, the supersymmetry can protect the mass of the Higgs state. It's possible to have a scenario where the visible sector has a Suzy breaking scale that's about 100 GeV, but the hidden sector has a scale that's a quarter GeV, and that, in that case, it just reflects the fact that the hidden charge of this hidden U1 prime could be smaller than the charge for standard electromagnetism. And so what this does is it gives you order GeV masses and also sort of GeV and sub-GeV mass splittings between superpartners. So in this scenario, the Y and Phi would actually be superpartners of each other. And this is contrary to sort of regular supersymmetric dark matter where it's a superpartner of a photon. Here, the entire dark sector is itself a super long problem. So it's just really supersymmetric. Differences that occur. So when you have the supersymmetric theory, you can decay also into swarfs as well as quarks. But the same idea happens. There's also another process that can occur where you can basically convert between different components of the supermultiplet. Convert scalars into fermions and vice versa. Even if you have this asymmetry, so it's like electrons turning into selectrons, kind of thing. And this is mediated by the gauge unit. So in this scenario, depending on the mass splittings between the states, you could end up only with one kind of dark matter particle. So this is the graph of the relative abundance in this theory of the fermion and the scalar. And in this case, because the fermion is lighter, all of the dark matter ends up in this fermionic state, and not very much ends up in the scalar state. Okay, so this is a theory of the origin of matter in the universe, what we've shown is that we're able to produce both dark matter and baryon numbers simultaneously, and that there is a new way to look for dark matter, namely, if you look in the Newtonian decay experiments, you might discover a signal of dark matter. Okay, so this took longer than I expected, so I don't have a lot of time for the second part of the talk. I'm going to do it more like an advertisement instead. But just before I move on, are there any quick questions at this stage? Okay, so. Let me get to the punchline here.
What about falling into this, Chris?
Yeah. So I'm just gonna advertise this closely. So this is a possible signature of the collision between two bubble universes. And so this is a novel, When Worlds Collide, describing the collision between planets. And similarly, this is imagining that we live in a universe that was nucleated at early times and formed as a bubble. And there's another universe that forms another bubble, and we have a collision between those two states. This idea shows up in the string theory landscape. So if you have a landscape of possible vacuum states and vacuum energies, then it's possible to have quantum mechanical tunneling between these different minima in the landscape, and this gives you the setup to have both eternal inflation happening, and then occasionally the nucleation of a bubble with a particular place in space tunnels into a different vacuum state in the landscape. That bubble expands. So you have tunneling from one point in the landscape to another point on this potential, and this tunneling goes through a Coleman-Dulitcher instanton, and inside of the bubble you create an open FRW universe. So you create this bubble, it's expanding, and then if you draw a space-time diagram of how stuff looks inside the universe, here's us at the Earth today. You can fit an entire hyperbola inside of these expanding bubble walls. And because of this hyperbolic slicing, you end up with an open FRW universe. Of course, we don't live in an open FRW universe. You have some inflation, which inflates this and gets rid of most of the curvature. And sort of the point here is that if you have one bubble, you might have many bubbles. And so if we live in this bubble, it's possible we can nucleate another bubble, and the wall of this other bubble will collide with ours, create a domain wall, which will penetrate into our bubble,
and then fly away at the speed of light. This process disturbs the reheating surface of the euclipton in our bubble and generates a particular shape of perturbation that you can look for in cosmology. And what we've done is we've calculated what this thing looks like. We calculated the temperature profile of what this particular perturbation looks like in the CMB. And in particular, we've also calculated the polarization pattern of what this thing looks like. And so you end up with a particular either radial or tangential polarization pattern that reflects symmetries between these bubble collisions. And you predict a very sharp double peak feature in the polarization. So sort of two concentric rings of polarization. And that's just occurring because you have our universe is some Hubble sphere. The bubble collision takes out a special direction, so that breaks symmetry. And then we end up with sort of a perturbation that has planar symmetry. And so this plane intersects our last scattering surface. And then if you ask what does an electron see in the last scattering surface, the electron's last scattering surface will either intersect this plane or not. And that's what gives you this double feature. So we calculated this double peak feature, and we're able to take the shape of this profile for this particular coherent perturbation, and in the presence of detector noise and also the normal random CMB fluctuations, we can estimate how easy it would be to detect this particular shape. And what we find is that for temperature, as you might expect, you can detect patterns of order a few times 10 to the minus 5 with upcoming CMB experiments. Polarization is much harder to detect. Smaller bubbles, smaller features in the angular sky and polarization, but for larger things, it's almost as easy to detect this signal in polarization as in temperature. And that's important because there's a lot of different ways you can generate sort of a temperature blob. And the distinguishing feature of this collision scenario in the early universe is we make this very symmetric perturbation. It's generically, it's really hard to make just randomly. You don't expect, you can have a 2D pattern that looks the same and have a very different 3D perturbation. And so this polarization signal is important as a corroborating evidence for this kind of effect. Okay, I'm going to skip almost everything here.
So the y-axis on those plots was the difference in temperatures between the two universes?
It was just the size of the observed signal in the CMB.
Okay, but how does that relate to the parameters of the early universe?
It turns out that all of the parameters in the early universe sort of get combined just into this one amplitude by inflation. Inflation has to get rid of everything. Okay, so the bottom line here is that, I would love to talk more about this with you afterwards, is that collisions in the early universe between bubble universes can create a particular feature in our Hubble volume that shows up in the scene of D. And we can predict now the temperature and polarization shape at late times in detail and try to look for this in the C of B and large scale structure. So that's one point. The second point is, if you ever write a paper about bubble universes, be careful, because people may try to put you into a bubble. Okay, that's it. Thanks.
If anyone has one super quick question, we'll take that now. Otherwise,
does anyone have a quick question?
Otherwise, we'll continue this upstairs. So if you want to ask Chris more about the cosmic quakes or any of those things, but he's here the rest of the day tomorrow.